Hi, my name is Lee McManus. I am the Public Affairs Officer at the U.S. Consulate in Karachi. Thanks for joining us on Hot FM 105 for a show called Sweet Jams and Chutneys. I'm here with Mohsen Raza Shah as our RJ. And for this show, we thought it would be fun and maybe a little educational to share with each other some of the best pop music that the United States and Pakistan has had to offer over the last several decades. And you get to hear my Midwestern accent from the United States, so I hope you understand me. I love all sorts of music, orchestral, rock and roll, Pakistani pop. I'm familiar a little bit with Qawwali music too. I think Mohsen, you might agree that if it's a good song, it's a good song. Doesn't matter where it's from or the background. So, just to, you know, introduce the show a little bit, we know there's literally a treasure trove of really good music in human cultural history. And we unfortunately have time only to play a very tiny few. And I would say, in terms of history, I love it too. You know, I'm an aficionado, I'm an amateur, I'm not a historian, but I like to know what's going on in a country, wherever I'm at. So Hot FM 105 and I, we thought we'd share with each other some thoughts of what was going on in our individual countries in that particular era when the songs came out. Because, and you might agree with this, Mohsen, to me, it's fascinating to consider that culture creates art, and art in turn influences or even creates culture. So it's a little bit of the chicken and the egg going on there.
I agree.
Yeah.
Hello, everyone. My name is Mohsen Raza Shah, and I'm going to be co-hosting this show with Mr. Lee right here. Thank you for the introduction.
Yeah.
And what we're going to try and achieve during this program is just a little bit of a glimpse into the music situations that were happening by year in our countries. And hopefully we'll be able to share with you some of our favorites or maybe some of the best songs of that respective era. And some of the songs I personally have not heard myself as well, so it's going to be new for me as well. We're going to have like fresh comments, fresh takes on what we think the music has to offer.
I can tell you, I've not heard 100% of the Pakistani songs you've chosen, so I'm really excited to learn from you.
I'm excited to show them to you, of course, yes. So shall we go on with the first song track?
Okay, so let me just introduce the first song, then our listeners can enjoy, and then we'll talk about it a little bit. It's a song from 1965 by musician Bob Dylan. His birth name was Robert Zimmerman, and then his stage name his whole life is Bob Dylan. And his biggest hit was called "Like a Rolling Stone." So let's have a listen.
Ever taught you how to live out on the street? get used to it. You say you never compromise with the mystery tramp, but now you realize he's not selling any alibis as you stand to the vacuum of his eyes.
So we're back. Hey, this is Lee McManus, Mohsin Reza Shah, here on Hot FM 105. And we're just delighted to be with you because who doesn't like to just sit down and have some sweet jams and chutneys? So I know I do. And Mohsin is a respected musician in his own right. So we started off with an American song by Bob Dylan called Like a Rolling Stone. And so I'm curious, Mohsin, what are your impressions? What do you think?
On first glance to the song, it does sound something that speaks a lot about freedom, something that speaks a lot about a nomadic lifestyle, yes. To be honest. And I'm not really sure of what was going on in the United States at that specific period of time, which kind of influenced this music. But when I listen to it, it makes me feel, it makes me want to wander a little bit. Like, makes me want to question and travel, and it's just kind of very thought-provoking as a song. I mean, when I read through the lyrics, it really did help me get an insight on what he was trying to say, although there's a little vague description, but I'm sure you can comment better on it.
Yeah, so this is one of those songs that I've heard growing up pretty much my whole life, and a lot of Americans have too. I think it was around 2011, there's a magazine, still exists, called the Rolling Stone magazine. And in 2011, it was ranked number one all-time biggest rock hit among 500 songs. So it really endured the test of time since 1965. Probably for a lot of reasons why it appeals to a lot of reasons. Just to riff off of what you said, Mohsen, about freedom. You know, the 60s came out of, the generation that was being more exploratory came out of a movement called the Beatniks of the 1950s, and so you had some Beatnik writers, principally Jack Kerouac comes to mind. He wrote a famous novel called On the Road. Then a lot of young people, kids, got into that scene and read that literature. And they were inspired by a musician from the 1940s and 50s called Woody Guthrie.
All right.
So he was a folk singer, and Bob Dylan was on the record of saying, hey, that was his idol who influenced him. So then what's really cool about Like a Rolling Stone to me, Mohsen, is principally Dylan became famous because of his acoustic work.
All right.
And he sang tons of, like, super popular acoustic folk music. For instance, Tambourine Man, that was another beat. There's so many in his repertoire. And then came along his idea, you know, I want to go electric. I want to be an artist. I want to have freedom to do what I want. So he did it with this particular song, and his loyal followers of the folk music scene, a lot of them were very angry with him.
I'm sure.
But he came out and he said, I'm doing it because this is me. I sing for me. I don't sing for the masses, because a lot of people wanted to pigeonhole him as a protest song writer, which he did write protest songs. Many come to mind from that era. One was, going way a little deeper cut of his acoustic time was Blowing in the Wind. A lot of people may have heard that one. The answer is Blowing in the Wind. Things are changing. The times are changing. So
you would say this was a little bit of the push that the revolutionary movement of that time really, because, I mean, the Beatniks were, if I were to comment, were, let's say, a deviance from what was the social norm at that time.
Yeah. I personally, maybe the conservative elements in the United States in the 1950s may have called them deviants. Now it just, you know, would just be considered mainstream.
All right.
Young people, another famous lyric, young people speak in their mind, comes from a different rock hit. But nonconformity and I don't even like to put it in the negative. I think it was just a matter of freedom of expression.
Of expression, yes. I agree.
The Beatniks had. And then it evolved into more of a hippie scene from the 1960s. So just a quick tidbit about this song, too, was the Beatnik writers, it was conducive to folk rock. And then everything evolved. Everything just got turned on its head musically in the 1960s. And we'll get into a little bit the next American song we listen to. The Beatles coming to America, what was known as the British invasion of music in the 1960s,
the Beatles.
That just like ignited the American music scene, saying, hey, we need to wake up. Look what these British people are doing, and they're being so creative and joyous in their songs, so why can't we? So along comes the folk music scene, among many others, who first acoustic, and then I would say in the mid-60s is when things started to become electric.
Absolutely.
So, why don't we move on to the first Pakistani song?
All right.
I'm excited to hear it.
For my first Pakistani song, it's going to be from 1966. It's called Coco Karina by Ahmad Rushdie. It's a version of Ahmad Rushdie's song. It's been composed by Sohail Rana. And it involves a mix of traditional Bangladeshi instruments as well as Pakistani instruments and Western guitar and drum influences as well. It's a powerful standout, a fun jam track, something to listen to while you're on the road. And here's Coco Karina by Ahmad Rushdie.
ख्यालों पे छाई है एक सूरत मतवाली सी नाजुक सी शर्मीली सी मासूम सी भोली भाली सी कहती है वो दूर कहीं अता पता मालूम नहीं कोको कोरीना कोको कोरीना कोको कोरीना कोको कोरीना मेरे ख्यालों पे छाई है एक सूरत मतवाली सी नाजुक सी शर्मीली सी मासूम सी भोली भाली सी रहती है वो दूर कहीं अता पता मालूम नहीं कोको कोरीना कोको कोरीना कोको कोरीना कोको कोरीना से गहरी आंखें जिसकी फूल सा जिसका चेहरा काली जुल्फे नागन पन कर देती है जिसपे पहरा झील सी गहरी आंखें जिसकी फूल सा जिसका चेहरा काली जुल्फे नागन पन कर देती है जिसपे पहरा तुम पूछोगे मुझसे दुनिया भर में कौन है ऐसा हसीन मेरे ख्यालों पे छाई है एक सूरत मतवाली सी नाजुक सी शर्मीली सी रहती है वो दूर कहीं अता पता मालूम नहीं कोको कोरीना कोको कोरीना कोको कोरीना कोको कोरीना हो सकता है कल खुद मुझको वक्त वहां ले जाए मैं घबराऊं देख के उसको वो मुझसे शर्म मैं कह दूंगा दिल पर मैंने शायद देखा है तुमको कहीं मेरे ख्यालों पे छाई है एक सूरत मतवाली सी नाजुक सी शर्मीली सी मासूम सी भोली भाली सी रहती है वो दूर कहीं पर अता पता मालूम नहीं कोको कोरीना कोको कोरीना कोको कोरीना कोको कोरीना
All right, so welcome back to our show Sweet Jams and Chutney. Mr. Lee, I just played you Coco Karina by Ahmad Rushdie, and I think it's a very nice sing-along pop song, something with a nice melodic melody that everyone can remember. It was really a household song back in the day, and I'm pretty sure every Pakistani has heard this play inside their house from one time to another. But what are your takes on it? What do you think of it?
That's very interesting. I could tell it's like really catchy.
Yeah.
So my initial impression was and is it just makes me want to dance.
Yeah.
And
it puts on a smile on your face because it's that entire major scale and those little melodic pieces in the middle that make you just want to have a good time. And it's like a happy-go-lucky song, in my
opinion. Yes, happy-go-lucky. That's a good word for it. So it came out in like a 65, 66?
1966,
okay.
Yes.
Okay.
And It's an upbeat and it's more of a lively tempo with modern instrumentation.
Yeah.
And so
tell me, what are some of the instruments?
I mean, you could definitely hear a guitar being played, both electric and acoustic in there.
Okay.
Rhythmically, they were using the dhol and the dotara, which is a traditional instrument from Pakistan. And the dhol does date back to Bangladesh. But back in 1966, Bangladesh and Pakistan were pretty much the same country. And
yes, indeed.
It was West Pakistan, I believe.
Yes.
So during that time, it was, I mean, I can't really comment on what was going on. I know it was pre-partition, for sure. But after this song, this kind of shows a brief time where things were pretty much all right. Everyone was happy. And this is, in turn, a love song. He's describing his lover, who happens to have beautiful eyes and a beautiful smile, and something that just makes his heart warm.
You know, the love songs that typically makes a person want to dance and be joyous.
Absolutely.
So I don't speak the local languages here in Pakistan. There wasn't time for the State Department to give me language training before I came here, but you know, often with music, maybe you'll agree, you can like get this sense of what they're singing about just through the emotion,
just through the melody.
Yeah,
honestly.
So I had a suspicion it was a love song, and I thoroughly loved it. I hope I hear it at some party I go to here in here in Karachi.
Hear a modern remix of this somewhere around here,
right? So, how old were you when you first heard that song?
I'm pretty sure it was playing around when I was 2 or 3 months old. Because I was exposed to a lot of music when I was young.
Yeah.
So, I'm sure this song has been played. And I've actually performed this song with a number of artists
as well. Oh, you're kidding.
So, it's very popular. It can be used as a wedding song. It can be used as an opener for, let's say, one of those corporate events where people just want to get the audience to kind of let loose, break the ice.
Yeah.
So this is the perfect icebreaker, in my opinion, for
completely.
A live setting.
I could totally see why. Well, thanks for sharing that, Mohsen.
I'll
put that on my own playlist.
Awesome.
Yeah.
So we've got many more.
Yeah.
How about we go on with another track from the United States?
Okay, cool. This is Lee McManus and Mohsen Raza Shah, and we're here on Hot FM 105 enjoying each other's music from our cultural history of Pakistan and the United States. So we're going to turn to an American song from, we're in the mid-60s here. This one's from 1966, a huge group at the time called the Beach Boys, and the name of the song is God Only Knows. So let's have a listen.
I may not always love you, but long as there are stars above you, you never need to doubt it. I'll make you so sure about it. God only knows what I'd be without you. If you should ever leave me, well, life would still go on, believe me. The world could show nothing to me. So what good would living do me? God only knows what I'd be without you. What I'd be without you.
Hey, we're back. Lee McManus and Mohsin Raza Shah here, sharing music with each other from the United States and Pakistan. So we've listened to our second American song on this first episode of Sweet Jams and Chutneys on Hot FM 105. And it was called God Only Knows by a group, a super group of its day called the Beach Boys. So Mohsin, as I understand it, that was the first time you may have heard that song. What are your impressions?
It's very nice. It's got a very good swing to it. My first impression would be Beatlesque. Like you said, we spoke about the British invasion happening earlier. And the music scene from Britain, I believe, was really influencing the new American artists at the time. You can hear a lot of the Beatles' notable elements in there, which happened to be like those vocal choirs that they were using as pads. Yeah. With harmonies, those three-part harmonies, which are known to be very popular with the Beatles. That, and then there's like this sing-along melody that is generally just making you bob your head left and right. Yeah. And it's nice. It's gonna put a smile on my face any day.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Funny you should say the word smile, because the lead singer of the Beach Boys, Brian Wilson, well, one of the lead singers, but he was the main songwriter. I think it was shortly after this album, they put out an album entitled Smile.
All right.
So whenever I listen to the Beach Boys and I want, you know, to pick up my mood, I randomly pick any of their songs. It puts a smile on my face. This particular song, and it's fascinating to me that you referenced the Beatles there, because this group, the Beach Boys and the Beatles, had a little friendly rivalry going across the pond, as
so
they
were
say.
Were they also a four-piece band?
I think there were five or six. I don't remember for sure. But most of them were brothers, and then like two or three childhood friends were in the Beach Boys. So the Beach Boys developed their own kind of style, known as like beach or surf rock, pop. And the early 60s, particularly after the British invasion in 1964, this particular California style became popular with the harmonies, as the Beatles were known for. And I'd say their earlier songs and albums by the Beach Boys were, you know, a lot more dancey. This song was, you could even say, contemplative, but if you listen to high volume and just get some good speakers, it's stereo. And that brings me to something I know about this song, which is Brian Wilson was heavily influenced by a music producer called Phil Spector. And Phil Spector, he produced a lot of like early rock and roll and developed a technique called the Wall of Sound.
The Wall of Sound.
The Wall of Sound. And Brian Wilson implemented that technique on this particular song. It's simplistic, but I mean, one of the things they do with it is like, so you say you've got a piano.
Yeah.
So instead of one piano playing, you're going to have three or four pianos playing the exact same thing at the exact same time. So it creates like this reverberation effect.
Absolutely.
Same with the harmonies, and like the Beatles, they did all these like overlays. So
a lot of layering, playing different instrument parts, having them spread out across the equalized spectrum of the track, making it sound bigger in turn.
Completely, that's exactly what happened. And this particular song is on an album called Pet Sounds, and Pet, you know, perhaps a play on words. You can have a pet like a dog or a cat, but, you know, pet something dear to you. And the Beach Boys said that they were inspired by the most recent Beatles album called Rubber Soul. And then the Beatles are on the record saying, we heard Pet Sounds and it blew the Beatles away.
Oh, wow.
And it heavily influenced the biggest rock album of all time, Sgt. Pepper's.
By the Beatles.
Everybody knows Sgt. Pepper's by the Beatles. So
I feel like this experience between the Beatles and the Beach Boys probably reflects on how music has no boundaries and
yes.
No barriers and no borders, actually.
Completely.
Them being inspired, although it was like a friendly rivalry, that
yes.
you would say, but them being inspired to make that album using another album speaks really well about how music can change people's opinions and not just keep it a competition.
I could not agree more, Mohsen. And you know, I put that particular rivalry emphasis on the word friendly. It was a friendly competition. So much so that Paul McCartney, to this day, one of the principal songwriters of the Beatles, he's on the record saying his favorite song is the song we just listened to.
Oh,
by
wow.
the Beach
that's
Boys.
A huge
God
compliment.
Only knows. Yes,
from coming, Paul McCartney, that's a
yes,
huge compliment.
Yeah, straight to the heart. And I, for myself, if I were to pick of all the hundreds of thousands of songs out there, I don't think I could pinpoint a favorite because I'm not a musician. I don't have the ear that you have, Mohsen, when it comes to
music. Well, I'm just a
listener.
I mean, you're an honest listener, and so am I. If it's all about how music makes you feel. So
yes.
I would agree we would be on the same page when it would come to what you would list down as your favorite. But Paul McCartney saying it was his favorite, that's a big deal.
Yeah, I agree. And then just a footnote about the song itself. If you read or listen to the song again and focus on the lyrics, this is what I love about music and songs, is there can be so many interpretations. No one interpretation is correct. So, like, this song takes me to another place, and it could be a love song. We all have people we love in our life. And there's references to God. So, one could interpret it as like, oh, well, no one knows what I would be without the higher source.
Absolutely.
Type of idea. So this is a very dreamy song to me, and like I said earlier, just if I want my mood to get uplifted, oftentimes I'll pull up a Beach Boys song.
Excellent.
Yeah.
So I would like to play a little game for this track in particular.
Yeah, let's do it.
I mean, the title is pretty obvious for me,
yeah.
but the next song that we listen to after this as well, and the song and this song. I want to ask you, what time of day or like what situation would you want to listen to it in? For example, I mean, from the title of the band, the Beach Boys, I would definitely want to have like a nice pair of shorts on, have a nice sandy beach, play this song, and definitely go for a dip.
Yeah, I agree. I have been to California beaches a lot in my life. There's another huge hit. I was actually conflicted which one to share, this song or another one called Good Vibrations.
All right.
But whenever I go to Southern California and I sit on the beach, there is a vibration there, and it is a good vibration.
Good
so
vibes.
I would put the headphones on as I'm soaking up some sun, looking at the beautiful ocean there. But you can do that anywhere. Anywhere where there's an ocean, ideal place to listen to the Beach Boys, but even at home, just before you go to bed, any time's good for me. But particularly if I want a little mood uplift, because these guys are so full of optimism.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely. That the major scale in there really just makes you want to smile.
Yeah. So I want to keep the good times rolling here.
Right.
So I'm really excited about our next Pakistani song.
So our next Pakistani song is going to be by Nazia Hassan, Nazia and Zuhaib, a big Pakistani music act. We're delving into a little bit of the later time after the 60s. We're jumping into the 70s.
Okay.
It's Aap Jaisa Koi by Nazia Hassan.
Okay, cool. Thank you.
everyone. This is Mohsin Reza Shah, and we are back with Sweet Jams and Chutney. I have Mr. Lee here with me, and we were just listening to Nazia Hassan's Aap Jaisa Koi. This song was actually one of the groundbreaking game changers of the time. It helped bring disco music to South Asia and beyond. It helped to create Nazia Hassan's legacy as a trailblazer in Pakistani and Indian pop music. The song speaks about love. The song speaks about a beloved. Once they enter your life, everything is perfect. Everything is good to go. What do you think about this?
Sweet. Yeah. When you get a female vocalist that has pipes like that, it melts me. I really dug it. I really liked it. Has like a swaying, dancey effect to me a little bit, but just particularly when we have women and men in our lives, but you know we're raised knee high often by our mothers, and so that the sound of a really good female vocalist always just goes straight to my heart. So I could see why that song was so popular. And it seemed like a little bit disco element to it. So I definitely see some club scenes going on where you dance to something like that.
The song's been interpreted by a lot of modern musicians as well. And it's a timeless classic, I would say. Something that if you just a little bit of speed on the tempo and you can dance to it. Uh-huh. But for me, like we played the game in the early one, for me, this track, it would be a nice city drives, driving through downtown, have those bright lights flashing by, and this song would play perfectly for me in that situation.
Yeah. Do you have a? Because I haven't had a chance yet to like drive on open highways. Do you have those areas in Pakistan?
Well, not where open it's just, highways, but we've got these nice boulevards. We've got Sunset Boulevard that takes you straight down.
Yeah.
Got the big buildings, nice street lights, advertisements, and all of those Zoom city metropolis things going on.
Yeah.
And if you're just driving by, this really does put a smile on your face.
Yeah, totally. In the American context, I think you've been there to the U.S.?
Absolutely, yes.
So you've seen the huge highways and the freeways. So everybody has their playlist for road trips.
Yeah.
I could see myself definitely have that on my track for a road trip.
Brilliant.
You know, mini rack up 10, 20 songs. I'd put that on there.
Sweet.
Yeah.
Sweet.
Yeah, that was a good one. Thanks for sharing that.
Well, that's it for this episode of Sweet Jams and Chutney. I hope you enjoyed the music that we had to play for you. And I hope this is also a reminder that music from the past, present, or the future can create good times and in any moment can take you to higher realms. My name is Mohsin Reza Shah, and with me I have Mr. Lee. Thank you for being here with us.
Thank you, Mohsin. It was really fun.
Hopefully you guys will tune into the next episode of Sweet Jams and Chutney, and we'll have some more fresh music for you coming soon.
Bye for now.